Hello, this is Anne, the guest of Anne Inside. This is February the 5th, and it is my birthday. So if you like the work I'm doing, please give me a thumbs up. It takes 1 nanosecond on YouTube, and it's really fully appreciated. And also, of course, spread the word. This is my first video on epidemiology, and we have a lot of good news. I finally can use the green color. And we have had, in the last 2 weeks, a 30% drop in the daily cases, a 24% drop in hospitalization. Unfortunately, the mortality is still pretty high because if you remember, there's a 3 to 4 weeks delay, so we'll talk about that. And we have now vaccinated around 8% of the US population has had at least one dose, which ironically is the same amount of people who officially have been infected. So it's kind of an interesting thing there. You don't want to miss the second video because I'm going to talk about the practical tips of what you should do to prepare yourself before vaccination, during vaccination, and after vaccination. There's a lot of new information about mutation and some of the latest vaccination data that has come up from several vaccines, and also new data, unfortunately, on long COVID. And again, to remember you, the key problem with this disease is not the mortality rate, it's the 10 to 30% chance of having permanent damage to your heart, your kidney, and your lungs. So you don't want to miss the second video. As you can see here, look at North America and my nice little red color there. That's a massive drop since January. In Europe is also going down, not as sharply as the US. We'll talk a bit about that. But for the first time, you're going to see in the world, we have a slowdown of the number of cases. If you look at successful countries, right now, there's around 13,000 cases per million in the world. So around 1.3% of the world population has been infected. And these are the ones reported. Remember, we think it could be underreported by a factor of 2 to 5x, depending who you're talking to. But the US, unfortunately, is leading the charge with one of the highest rates in the world. Belgium, which had one of the highest mortality rates, is just tagging behind that, as well as France. But compare this to China and Taiwan. I mean, that's the disparity we see across the world in how we have responded to this virus. And the big thing about that is the ability of the Asian countries in putting social distancing, literally quarantining whole population there very quickly there, doing contact tracing with huge SWAT team of people doing contact tracing and doing quarantine and isolation of people who are at risk. So something we haven't been able to do in the US. So you can see it's starting to go down a little bit there. It's slowing down in its curve. We have over 100 million cases in the world with over 2.3 million deaths. And the good news, for the first time, you can see the world is going down. Of course, that's being led by the US going down, but that's the first time we've seen a 23% drop. And that's great news. Hopefully that's the winter peak that everybody was afraid of. And that's, of course, before the mutation has had a big impact. Mortality rate also for the first time has been going down a little bit there. So these are all great news. Let's look at the mutation there. You can see here, France had this huge spike in October. Then we had the UK mutation there and a full lockdown of the UK. South Africa, huge mutation again there. We'll talk more about that. And again, a lockdown there. Lockdown do work. And so I think it's a lesson to learn is that as soon as a mutation there, we need to absolutely isolate them if we can. Brazil has another mutation called the P1 mutation there, and they're kind of flat right now. So we need to keep an eye on them. Hotspot in the US and the UK, these are all great news. These are massive drop. And again, it's a combination in the UK, a very, very strong lockdown in the US where people are finally starting to make a better effort in wearing masks and being socially distancing. And a lot of the new regulation have come up in the last 3 to 4 weeks. You can see the Europe is slowing down, but it's not at the rate of the US, which is really dropping like a rock, which is really wonderful to see. So Europe is like whack-a-mole. It's the only way I can explain it. I mean, you have one country that explodes, and that was France. And then you have Belgium exploded. And then you have Netherlands and that exploded there. And you have Spain and you have Portugal. And so pretty much Europe is on lockdown. And there's a pretty much more and more restriction inside Europe that has happened there. I just was talking to my family in Belgium there where they're pretty much, you know, locked down at home. Not technically not able to even see their, you know, the grandchildren, things like that. So as a result, there's a shortage of vaccine, and the UK just announced, because they're under severe attack by that mutation there, that they're doing a trial to mix and match the vaccine which is the first dose, maybe a Moderna, the second dose, maybe a Pfizer or AstraZeneca there. And they just started that trial there. And the good news is that they were ahead of the Americans. They have already vaccinated 15% of their population. By vaccinated, they have at least one dose, I should say. And what they're looking at is to say, well, what happens if the second dose is not available when we need it? Should we give it later? So let's say at 3 months instead of 4 weeks. And should maybe we give a different type? And that's what they're looking at. The UK has had over 100,000 deaths. All the schools are closed. All but the essential shops are closed. Socializing outdoor is banned, except, you know, if you're doing exercise in pair. They've had problem in contact tracing and testing. And the big problem they have is very poor compliance. And that's because people have to work. And so 38% of people have not isolated themselves after they had symptoms. And 13%, even after they've been tested positive, don't isolate them. So I think there's a lot of cultural issue going on there. And they were also very slow at restricting traveling and quarantine, where Europe, the continental Europe, has been much stricter. So let's look at the US. Great news again. We have gone 2 weeks ago at around 200,000 cases. Remember, we're as high as, you know, in this case, as high as 300,000 cases several weeks ago, to 126. Hospitalization is going down. That's the first time we've seen that there. And the death rate is going down, but you could see the average death rate is still over 3,000 per day, which is still staggering numbers. The dashboard, you can see, it depends on the states. Clearly, the southeast corridor there is still the darkest color, especially, you know, Texas and Arizona. And so there's a disparity, you know, from state to state on what's happening there. Typically, there's a 3 to 4 weeks lag from the time you have an increase in the number of cases low for people being hospitalized, and another 3 to 4 weeks for people, unfortunately, mortality. So the good news, you can see the number of patients going to hospital are going down, you know, keeping on track of the case going down. But unfortunately, we still have that delay in mortality, and we had one of the highest mortality rate a few days ago at over 4,000, 4,500 cases there. So unfortunately, we're still losing a lot of Americans on a daily basis. The whole state, region by region, is going down, and you can see how high it went in the south, you know, so it's going down, but still a long way to go back to normal. So we should not celebrate too quickly there and go back to normal. This is another great news here. You remember, this is a graphic that keeps track of the highest daily case record per state. And what was really worrisome when we had that huge surge a month ago is that pretty much on a daily basis, they had these new daily cases there. And really for the last 2 weeks, we didn't break any records. And that's great news because that means we're slowing down, pretty much everywhere. And you can see that in a number of new cases per million. This is a comparison to what we had 2 weeks ago. You can see a lot of the dark colors in the southeast area there. And there's still some, but you know, it's clearly getting better in the incidence case per million. If you look at the positivity of PCR, we still have stayed in the red, where the positivity rate is above 10 to 15%. The goal of the World Health Organization is 5%. So we still have a problem in the positivity rate. Again, Arizona, Southern California, the whole Southeast corridor here is still in trouble, but significantly better than what it was a month ago. So we're going in the right direction. Hospitalization rate is going down, and some of them are quite significant. California dropped by 18%, New Mexico by 20%, Tennessee by 22% there. So pretty much 38 states are going down, 12 states are staying the same. So these are all great news because a lot of the hospitals were being overwhelmed, and some of them were having problem, you know, getting oxygen and all of the other problem there. And you can see that by the admission per 100 beds has gone down. This is compared to 2 months ago. The whole, pretty much half the country was in deep red. And you can see now we're starting to see some of the green and the blue colors, which is a low amount of admission per 100 beds. Vaccination is great news. It's absolutely done a fantastic job in the last, I will say, 3 to 4 weeks. We now have 28 million Americans who have at least got one dose, which is as many people as technically got infected. We have around 7 million who have received the two doses. And in the second video, we'll talk a little bit more about how much time it takes before you get protected. Pfizer and BioNTech, you know, is a little bit ahead in the number of doses being given there. But these are the two drugs, vaccine that have been approved in the US. There may be more coming up in the next few weeks. Take a look at the second video. And you can see that in the long-term care, where we have had the majority of the mortality rate, not long-term care, which is nursing home, had over 40 to 50% of the mortality rate. That's the great news. We have already vaccinated, close to, 3 million people there. And of course, the one we really want to vaccinate is the resident. There has been some resistance where in some states, only half the staff have been willing to get vaccinated due to some concern or lack of education. You know, we won't go into that right now. So the dashboard is that we have really taken off in the number of vaccination per day. At the rate we're doing it right now, which is at 1.3 million per day, which is stunning compared to where we came from a few weeks ago. I think President Biden is trying to get to 1.5 million a day, and I'll share more about some of the plans they're working on. It will still take December for us to vaccinate 90%. That's assuming people want to get vaccinated. The good news is more and more people who have been willing to vaccinate, but you can see the quick change, how quickly we increase the pace there in the number of vaccination there. So I think we're drastically improving the rollout of the vaccine. They've just announced that the government is not going to be working with the pharmacy network to drastically increase the availability of the vaccine to the population there. So starting on February 11, so next week, they're going to ship 1 million doses to 6,500 stores. And it's going to be CVS, Walgreens, Walmart, and Publix. And CVS is going to be in 11 states initially. Walgreens is going to be in 15 states. CVS is hiring 10,000 technicians there to administer the vaccine. This is what was missing. We made the dose, but there was nobody to give it. I mean, I don't know what they were thinking, but let's not go there. And right now they're following CDC and state eligibility. So if the state saying is 65 and above, you can get it. But if another state is 75, they only give it to the 75 years old. You can book online or on the phone. It has no cost to people. It's paid by the government. They expect to get to an ability to get to 100 million vaccine doses in 1 month. So they're really cranking it up to expand that initial number of stores from 6,500 to 40,000. And that's going to expand to people like Kroger and to large retailers like Walmart and Costco. And the objective is to get to 3.3 million vaccinations per day. So pretty much doubling. More than doubling what we're doing today. And right now, this seems to be on track in achieving that. California has dropped 65% from the peak we had 4 weeks ago. That's fantastic news because we had really a hot spot there. And you can see we've dropped from 33,000 cases 4 weeks ago, 2 weeks ago to 15,000. And we were much higher up, 4 weeks ago. Positivity rate jumped from 10 to 6%. That's fantastic news. Also, remember, we're trying to get below 5%. The death rate, unfortunately, is still going slightly up because of that delay. And the hospitalization is also starting to come down. So these are all great news. In the dashboard for vaccine, a lot of the vaccine, as you would expect, is in the Los Angeles area there. It's probably a third of the vaccine. You know, we're into the county of Los Angeles there, followed by San Diego and Orange County, that whole area there that was hit really, really hard there. But I think California is finally starting to be able to increase the administration, which is around 4 million out of 6.4, where before we were at 23% of the those being shipped having been administered. So I think we're really expanding the network and improving the ability of getting into people's arms. So sorry, I'm having a problem with my slides here. This is another new slide. The government had put together this new website called healthdata.gov, and there's a beta site that I got access to. And you can see that the big drop in California, and they have this state by state if you're interested, is really the 40 to 69 years old with that really driving that hospitalization. And that's of course the area there where most people are spreading the vaccine. The virus is the people between 40 to 50 years old there. And so you can see the big drop there is in that dark green there. And unfortunately, people are older, which is unfortunately being given by the younger population. There still are a big chunk of people in the hospital settings. This is an interesting graphic that I got, and is that, is history going to repeat itself? And let's look at some of the numbers. This was done by the Hoover Institution here at Stanford. And they look at what happened in the Spanish flu of 1918 versus the Asian flu in 1957, 1958. And you can see we had that first little wave there, which would be equivalent to basically the spring of 2020. And then a big wave we just are going through right now. You can see how quickly it dropped. And then they had that third little wave there in the spring, which is the one we're trying to avoid. And then in the case of the 57, 58, they had that first wave and then that second wave in the spring there. So we want to make sure that we'll be cautious here because we had that drop in January, which is where we are. We don't want to have that second wave in the spring. And then they look at the numbers. And to give you an idea of, it's pretty incredible. In the 1918-19 population, the world population was a bit, was 1.9 billion people as opposed to 7.8 billion people today. The mortality rate, which is the implied infection rate, was around 2.2% of the people who had the mortality rate. And if we use some of this data and basically adjust them to 2020 there, it would mean that we will have 96 million people in the US infected. So a third of the US population there with a mortality rate of 2 million. Right now we are around 450,000. And so their argument was to say, we may be closer to the story of what happened in 57, 58, which had a lower infection rate through the population there. So in this case, it would be around 82 million people there. And of course their mortality rate was around 215. So that's a lower mortality rate. And so I think the point of this argument there is that there may be a new surge that we need to be careful of in March that we need to keep an eye on. They also look at the economic cost, and it turns out that the economic cost we've had because we did more shutdown than they did in 1918, where they just let the virus go through the economy, is that we pretty much wiped out 1 year of GDP in this year there. And the other thing they looked at is to say, okay, well, how do we look about what the world estimates are? And they had this really weird analogy there, which is, remember, this was after World War II, that the mortality that happened in 1918 is because people refused to wear masks, sounds familiar, and pretty much those droplets and aerosols, the same problem we have right now, were like machine guns because they were invisible and it was a delay in mortality there, but they say it was really a problem of people not taking their responsibility. And if you look at the economic growth versus education, is there a cost of income in the US because of the delay in the school education that is happening right now? And they look at the test score versus the conditional growth rate. You can see there's a relationship between the school test score and versus the growth rate of this country there. Like this is Taiwan, for example, Hong Kong and China. And so they calculate that the learning loss in the US because of the online classes and the fact that some of the colleges and the school had a partial shutdown is equivalent to 4.3% of GDP loss, which is quite significant. And then the concern that they express is the fact that that generation may have a loss that may take several years to be able to catch up. And so I thought that was interesting analysis. And then they had an argument to say, well, right now we initially thought in August, it's going to be like a third of a year loss. And then now we're getting close to it thinking it could be a two-third or even 1 year setback, in the learning, and that will have an impact in the GDP slowing down there. So I wanted to share that data there. They also did an analysis in the real gross domestic product decline, which was the largest ever that we have had, which was a drop of 31% that we had when we did the shutdown in the second quarter. And you can see that we have the economy has now rebounded quite drastically there. But if you look at the unemployment, we pretty much created 22.7 million jobs between 2010 and 2020, and we whacked them all out in April. 10 years of job creation basically disappear. And you can see some have bounced back, but we're still below the normal level we had in March. So that was kind of a bit sobering. And if you compare this from state to state, you can see there's a big difference between Idaho versus, let's say, Hawaii or New York, where you had a much difference in drops in employment there. So state by state is very different. So the employment loss is also different states. So in this case, this was a presentation by the Hoover Institute on the Western states, so California and other states. And you can see the big drop was leisure and hospitality. The restaurants, the whole entertainment industry got really very hard, as well as transportation. That was kind of really a big drop there. And compared to the what's called the Great Recession of 2008, you can see there's a very big difference in the industry sector that took the hit. And so the concern there is that some sectors are being hit so hard, you know, will they recover? And again, showing the difference in the drop up to 40 to 50% of the leisure and hospitality business basically has dropped. That's a massive loss in that sector there. So stay positive, test negative, and get vaccinated. This is a picture of Dr. Fauci. And please take a look at my second video where I'm going to do a deep dive of what you need to do to get ready for your vaccine. What's the latest data on vaccine and how long they last and what you should do if there is a variant and more information on long COVID and how to protect yourself after the vaccine. So please stay tuned and watch the second video.